Greetings and welcome to the Badger Cave's West Wing, where our stealthy polecats ferret out the best feels, funnies, and what the fucks to discuss, slam bam, badger style. Your sinuous hosts for this evening are, myself, Supreme Doge in Charge, our polecat punster Hannah, Dr. Randomer Cam, Panda at Large, Max, Simpson Skin, not jaundiced, and normally we would have our anchorilla Scott, but unfortunately Scott has a numb mouth and cannot come on. I have fulfilled my legal obligations. You can now draw your own conclusions. This evening, we'll be covering the following topics. Duke University has offered a safe space for men to discuss their toxic masculinity. Just what we wanted. See, feminism is for men too. The feminist bookstore, Women and Women First, from popular TV show Portlandia, the sketch comedy show about hipsters and feminists, is protesting the show's trans misogyny. When life imitates art. Playboy, now under new management, features a woman who takes photographs in a hijab and makes a forceful case for modesty. A teen boy from Saudi Arabia is arrested for unethical behavior after he appeared on a YouTube video with a popular teen girl star. And finally, our bonus story for the patron-only after show. Halloween is already on everyone's minds, which means candy, jack-o'-lanterns, spooky decorations, and sexist costumes that women must wear like the shackles that keep them chained to the stove. Anyway, you want to listen to this topic or enjoy further personalized discussion with the Badgers on select topics, become a patron at www.patreon.com/honeybadgerradio. And now, here is myself and Mr. Max with news. So, let us begin with, let's see, how about we start with Duke? Max, tell us about Duke University.
Sure, Doug.
Safe spaces.
All right, so.
Whatever. Go ahead. Go on.
It's yours. Yeah. So I got to ask everybody on the panel, well, specifically the men, and everybody else in the chat.
Are you gendering us? Because
you. Those who identify as men, I'm sorry. I got to go flagellate myself. Can I wait until after the show?
I don't identify as identifiable. I'm offended.
Oh, for Christ.
I don't identify as offendable.
Although, you could make this statement directly to Lauren Southern, who is now a man. So, go ahead.
Yeah. That. Okay. Do you hate yourself? Do you consider it acceptable to legitimize concepts like toxic masculinity and not toxic femininity? Duke University in North Carolina is now offering a program called the Duke Men's Project. That doesn't sound gay at all. Hosted by the Campus Women's Center. The nine-week program is for male-identified students that to discuss male privilege, patriarchy, the language of dominance, rape culture, pornography, machismo, and other topics. The student newspaper editorial board endorsed the new program yesterday, insisting it was not a re-education camp being administered by an oppressed group in the service of the feminization of American society. Furthermore, Junior Dipro Baumick, who sits on the leadership team, said the goal of the project was for male students to, quote, critique and analyze their own masculinity and toxic masculinities to create healthier ones. I, Max Derrett, would like to offer a personal rebuttal to that. I believe that this isn't a re-education camp when you offer a program that asks women to examine their toxic femininity. This isn't the first program of its kind, as it is patterned off of a similar one at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, where participants are asked to contemplate how masculinity plays a harmful influence in lives. In summary, if you wish to become a future college student, don't go to North Carolina unless you play basketball really freaking well.
Well, I definitely want to talk about this one later. Toxic masculinity as a concept seems to be something that I'm seeing more and more and more, and I'm sickened by it personally.
I think we should start talking about toxic feminism.
Yeah, toxic
ideology. This is definitely an aspect of toxic feminism.
Yeah, definitely. Also, I know you guys can't see this, but Omar Epps is looking really good for his age these days. that's from the photo from the from the article. All right, I'll go ahead and read the next. But actually, no, you go ahead, Max. Tell us about Women and Women First, the bookstore story.
Well, in case you guys didn't know, The dream of the 90s is alive in Portland. That's no? Right. Nobody here watches that?
No, I watch that. Yeah, it's from the song. I asked you if you saw the show, and then you couldn't respond.
So. I actually don't watch the show that much. I'm just aware of a few skits, that one in particular. The dream of the 90s is alive in Portland. But you would know that if you watched Independent Film Channel's famous sketch series, like Brian said, Portlandia. And when I say the dream of the 90s, I refer to the seeds of political correctness that were sown during that decade. Now, for the past 6 seasons of this show, apparently the crew behind Portlandia has been filming sketches about a feminist bookstore named Women and Women First. In real life, the store is known by a different name, In Other Words. Yeah, that's the name of the shop, In Other Words. Get it? However, the store is still a women's community center and features lots of feminist literature. However, it appears that Portlandia and In Other Words have forever severed ties. This past week, reports have come out regarding a sign that In Other Words has posted on its door. I should just start doing that like Dr. Evil. The sign reads as follows. Fuck Portlandia. Transmisogyny, that's a word. Racism, gentrification, queer antagonism, devaluation of feminist discourse. And that was it.
Oh.
A writer for online news outlet, Willamette Week, contacted a representative from the store. The representative said that the store might be willing to answer questions. However, the possibility of this happening ceased after, In Other Words, asked multiple times via email to link an online fundraiser for the bookstore. Willamette Week declined as a matter of policy, saying they wouldn't promise a link to the fundraiser in exchange for an interview. In response to this, the representative for, In Other Words, said the following. After some consideration and research, we've decided to officially tell the Willamette Weekly to go fuck themselves. Your paper has absolutely zero journalistic professionalism, and you are scummy rape apologists. What? Thanks for the opportunity, though. Have a great night. Yes, that was word for word the message the bookstore sent to Willamette Week. And in case you were wondering, when they said, thanks for the opportunity, though, the representative wrote the word, though, in typical snarky fashion with a T-H-O.
Oh. This is the bookstore, in other words. This is hilarious because they are taking a setting, which apparently they didn't have a problem with allowing them in for 5 seasons. Because I believe they're on the 6th season now. They didn't have a problem letting them film the skits there. And then they have a problem in the 6th season, which makes me wonder what changed. But the entire time, this feminist bookstore skit was actually the most popular. They're the most popular characters on the whole show, like of all the characters they play. And it's mainly because the feminist characters are so ridiculous. I mean, they're offended by everything. And people find it funny. I mean, they're... Yeah.
Actually, Brian, I think I know why they didn't complain for the first 6 seasons. I mean, we're all pretty much aware that feminists don't really get humor that well, right? Mm-hmm. So maybe for the first 5 seasons of the show, they watch these sketches and they don't realize that they're being made fun of.
That's what I was going to say. This is feminism has become a poe of itself. They probably thought it was a positive portrayal and just now figured it out.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah,
we've gone from useful idiots to useless idiots.
I'm gonna go ahead and ask you to stop using your finger.
Imagine letting somebody film a parody of yourself in your home, your business that you own for 6 years, and not realizing that it was a parody.
Yeah.
The bad thing is that just means that they really are like that.
This is funny. Maybe you come back to that one, but I'm gonna go ahead and go on to the next one. If you guys know Portlandia, you have to know how fucking ridiculous that is. All right, so let me see what the next story is here. It might not be the Playboy one. Oh no, it is The Modesty of Playboy. About a year ago, Playboy magazine threw out the nude photographs to write about things like race and gender. They now have their first women to wear a hijab. In an article entitled Noor Taghori Makes a Forceful Case for Modesty, Noor discusses her goals and the backlash she has gotten from being a hijab-wearing news anchor and a badass activist, according to Playboy's own words. Noor talks about the first story she did with Newsy on how Middle Easterners were considered white without privilege, she claims, on the U.S. Census, and the backlash that ensued. She insists the story was based on facts. In an interview on CNN about the Playboy controversy, Noor talked about how she aimed to combat the objectification and sexualization of women in the media on Playboy magazine. By being her authentic self wearing a hijab, she feels she is breaking the barrier in Playboy. She wants people to know what it means to be a Muslim American woman and wants others to break barriers and glass ceilings to reclaim their power.
Oh. I know everybody here has something to say. Anna, you go first.
Playboy magazine officially has no point of existing anymore. This is not, you know, objection to the religion. This is not objection to women who make the choice to cover their bodies. This is an objection to any of that. You can walk down the street wearing anything you want. I don't care. Go to the grocery store in it. I don't care. But to turn around and say that skin mags have to adapt to your sensibilities, don't open the damn skin mag. It's a really simple thing. Don't open the cover and look inside, and you won't be offended.
I want to come back to the Playboy one for lots of reasons. Now, I know there are people who want to say Playboy's dead because of the internet. You know, that's a whole other animal altogether. But I think there's something truly sinister about this that I really want to examine closer. Mike, did you want to say something? I thought Mike.
It's funny that she goes, she said, break barriers and glass ceilings and reclaim our power. And I think of how many people will listen to that and go, ha ha, you want power? What do you mean power? You're a Muslim woman. You want to bring about a system in which you have no power at all. And it's weird that she would want that kind of power, isn't it? It makes sense for men to want to spread Islam because it gives them power.
Yeah.
Do you see the disparity yet, ladies and gentlemen? I'm saying yes. You're right. It is bizarre that she wants to bring about a world of Islam because she would have no power. But it's just as bizarre for the men when Muslim men say we want to reclaim our power because they're not getting any power from Islam either.
Seems
they're all deluded. Do you see?
All right. So we'll come back to Noor Taghouri and her Playboy appearance. Meanwhile, teen boy arrested for talking to teen girl online, basically. A teen boy has been arrested in Saudi Arabia for chatting to a girl online. Abu Sin, the 19-year-old boy, and Christina Crockett, an American YouTuber, streamed with each other despite language barriers. Abu Sin danced and jokingly professed his love for her. But this was a joke, meant to be funny. Abu was arrested for unethical behavior and is facing up to 3 years in prison. Apparently, this is not the first time a Saudi internet user has been arrested for videos. A young man was arrested by the religious police for protesting photos, for posting photos of himself offering free hugs in 2013. That's the short version of it. So, teen boy and talking to a blonde, blue-eyed American young girl on YouTube. Teen Arab boy is arrested for it.
Oh my god!
Yeah. So how's that privilege going?
So, yeah. am I gonna get in trouble with the public if I turn around and say that I've been told repeatedly that it's only women's sexuality that is repressed in Saudi Arabia?
Well, go ahead, Mike. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say this is what Playboy wants.
Right after the Playboy article. Isn't it funny?
Yeah.
I wonder if it's Playboy. I wonder if it's more being pushed on them. And this is something that you see happen in media. And I'm wondering, you know, granted, Playboy is a pretty big empire, but I mean, how old is Hugh Hefner?
Oh, I don't know. He's
all the old.
He's
over,
like
over 9,
he's older than time itself.
Father Time could probably remember when he was a little kid sneaking looks at his father's Playboy magazines, right? I doubt he's running the show anymore. And
no. Hugh Hefner's daughter, I believe, is running Playboy now, and she's a feminist. That was already
That explains a lot.
Then it was shortly after that they said they were going to take all the nudes out.
Well, that makes sense. I mean, growing up with Hugh Hefner as your dad, I mean, I can only imagine that would be the only outcome that she would end up being, unless she happens.
I don't think so. No, I'm sure there were other outside influences, because quite likely, just by the nature of the lifestyle that he had, Hefner had to have taught the lesson of, you know, you deal with the consequences of what you, you know, if you set him up, it's your job to knock him down. If you get set up and knocked down because you weren't watching, it's not just the other person's fault. You know, and I know that's probably harsh to a lot of people.
Sure.
But I'll bet that she grew up with, at least from one angle, the message that it is your job to watch your back. But I will bet she also went to college because they had money, lots of money. And kids who grow up in wealthy households get some kind of a degree or another, or they go to something along the modern lines of finishing school. I don't know if finishing schools even still exist anymore, but they go to something like that. They don't just go straight from growing up into business, you know. And it's quite likely that she got exposed to feminism in an academic setting, which is why she's going the Islam is wonderful route. But no, I'm thinking of this. And I joke about getting in trouble for saying that, but the thing is, it's been a rather big deal on Twitter for me, at least, any time, except for the very most recent time when I simply posted a link to a news story about a Saudi princess's behavior. Anytime I mention that oppression in under an Islamic regime is not limited to women, but that bad things happen to men and boys there too, it seems like I get a flood of social justice types calling me a misogynist for saying so. Mm-hmm. And then you get stories like this that come out, and you wonder, who's going to stand up for this guy? I mean, it's great that there's people standing up for Saudi women. There was a short time where I was under the impression that Twitter was censoring the Stop Enslaving Saudi Women hashtag. And it was because it looked like that's what was going on, but I've since learned that it was just being mass reported. Twitter wasn't censoring it, but there were people who were opposed to what was being said in it who were mass reporting people for posting to it. But it would be wrong to censor that. Even if I disagree personally, I disagree with focusing just on women. I think it's great that they have somebody to stand up for them. But who's standing up for boys like this young man? You know, here's a 19-year-old, gets arrested for talking to a girl. Who's going to stand up for him?
Exactly. All right, so those are basically all the stories. I think we want to get into all of them a little bit. So I'm going to go back to the Duke one. I want to give you guys a little bit more info. So let's go through the article. So let's see. The program seeks to shift the culture of masculinity towards more nonviolent norms. The underlying assumption being that violence is currently the norm for men. It's hard to imagine any other group on campus participating in a similar program, much less doing so under the banner of a safe space. Duke's new program is patterned off a similar one at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, where participants are asked to contemplate how masculinity plays a harmful influence in lives. So, there was a time where feminists did not want to talk about men's issues at all. They didn't even think that they had any because they were privileged. Then, this is just the pattern that I've noticed. As men's rights activist voices have grown louder, feminists' abilities to dismiss, defame, and smear them have not been working out, because more and more people are starting to talk about it. And they're also at the simultaneously getting a little sick of feminism. And then suddenly, feminism decided that it did care about men. But, with a caveat, the way that they think that men could be, that men need help is that they need to be saved from themselves, because all the problems that men have are still a product of their masculinity, of the, essentially it's the patriarchy hurts men too narrative. And they're just doubling down on it. And now they're saying that masculinity itself, I mean, there was a video that was released recently called Unboxing Masculinity by this one guy. And it became, he was really small and then he became really popular because he's a, he made a lot of these unboxing videos and they're all just based on false narratives and bullshit. And he did this one unboxing masculinity. They've stopped calling it toxic masculinity now. They're just calling it masculinity. So the thing is, they're demonizing masculinity itself. Like, there's something wrong with men. They're just broken. They're not like women, I guess, or they're not the way that they think they should be. And now this stuff is getting into colleges, and they're basically creating spaces for men to go to feel bad about what they are and try to adjust their behavior. It's repulsive. So, Max, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, it's just, I don't understand why we have to term it as toxic masculinity. Like, you know, you watch John McIntosh and he tries to rationalize it saying, oh, well, the term toxic masculinity obviously implies that there are good forms of masculinity. Okay, well, that's fine. But why is, and I know it just sort of sounds stereotypical to say this, but if you're going to talk about toxic masculinity, why isn't there a forum talking about toxic femininity? How is that supposed to convince naysayers that the current form of feminism isn't out to try and disparage men? And it's supposed to be about creating equality, right? Why does it have to be under this particular paradigm? Unless you're completely slavish to the feminist way of looking at things and how it can never possibly do wrong. You know, I figure, you know, if you want to set up this paradigm and we want to work within that particular matrix, we can start there and then move beyond that. But first, you got to try and establish what some forms of toxic femininity are. Or are you too scared to do that because, like the rest of you, you're too afraid of being called misogynist?
I can actually answer some of that just because I went through for another show and researched the term toxic masculinity. And I traced its usage back to writing by Raewyn Connell, who at the time of writing about toxic masculinity, at the time of coining the term toxic masculinity, Raewyn Connell was Robert Connell, and apparently averse to being male and averse to masculinity. And I looked at Connell's early writing on masculinity, and in particular set of writings that where that term was kind of coined as a feminist use of the term, and it pretty much mirrors what Andrea Dworkin has to say about men and masculinity. And the more I've looked at it, I think the reason that feminists generally don't, like, you can find the phrase toxic femininity buried in academic feminist journals and stuff, and little caveats here and there to, oh yeah, there's toxic femininity too. And it's always things like, you know, women do too much for other people, blah, blah, blah. You know, never really anything that's either uniquely feminism, you know, related, or feminist, feminine, or necessarily always toxic. But toxic masculinity seems to have been created specifically as feminism's, the feminist religion's version, I guess you could say, of original sin.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's, without feminism, you can't be a good person if you're a man, because you were born evil. So you have to accept feminism as your personal religion, and your feminist professors and the feminist women around you who tell you what they want of you as your personal saviors, or you're stuck in this eternal trap of your original sin of having been born a man. And it strikes me, it's the perfect thing for a guy to write if he's going through a crisis of identity where he's averse to masculinity and averse to being a man, and is in the future going to transition as a transgendered woman. And it's not saying that trans women are bad. It's simply saying that his aversion, you know, and now her aversion to masculinity does not necessarily translate into an accurate description of either masculinity or toxicity. It's simply what Connell was going through when Connell was questioning Connell's identity. And, you know, buying into things that Andrea Dworkin says about men is never a good idea.
But that's the dwark side. That's the radical feminist side. That doesn't represent all feminists.
Then all feminists.
Most of them.
All feminists then should avoid ever using the phrase toxic masculinity because it traces back to Dworkin. Mm. It should be abandoned.
You have to wonder how many people go through a phase where they just don't like being human, or they just don't like being themselves, or, you know, you just have a crisis of identity. And, you know, when it happens to girls, they're more likely to have people around them, like friends and family, reassuring them that being themselves is a good thing. And boys are slightly less likely to have this.
Yeah.
Maybe that explains more than any of the feminist ideas.
When you think about it this way, we were all kids once. You know, we all did kid things. We all liked kid things that we don't necessarily like as adults because we're more interested in other things now. And we all enjoyed things that we don't enjoy anymore because we enjoy other things now. And we all had fears that we've grown out of, you know. Except for clowns, and those guys are everywhere now, apparently. But no, it's, we don't turn around and say toxic childhood. You know, we romanticize your childhood. Just because you grow and change as a person, and something, you slough off something, that it's not you anymore. You know, and maybe it was just a stage of your development, or maybe it was something that never fit you. It doesn't necessarily make it bad for everybody.
You know, there is if men and boys can engage in behavior as individual men and boys that we could consider toxic or destructive, and women and girls as individuals can also engage in behavior that is toxic, then that means that there could theoretically be something that people could call toxic masculinity and toxic femininity. Why do we even gender these things when it's just human nature that there is a chance that some of us as individuals can engage in toxic things? Why are we even gendering it at all? Unless it's to control a part of the population by using that word and making it sound more important than it is. By basically putting it into academia, as in the case with this Duke thing, and saying that this is a specifically a man thing. Like, I looked at one of the comments and someone resented the way that the article was written because they said, oh, well, people, you know, should be able to find out what it is about them that's destructive, and why wouldn't there be something like this for toxic masculinity as long as there's something like this for toxic femininity? Well, the answer is there won't be anything like this for toxic femininity because feminism needs women to be without agency at all. So in order for it to survive and perpetuate itself, that means that if they're going to have a conversation about what's wrong with men on the whole, they cannot acknowledge that women can even behave anything like that. That's why they do their best with the manipulation of statistics regarding things like rape, things like interpersonal relationship violence, like domestic violence, as well as toxic masculinity. All these things, in their eyes, is a man problem. Even when women engage in it.
Yeah, if you're talking about spiders, if you're talking about toxic arachnitude, then you've got a good point. If you're talking about rats, toxic ratitude, then you had a fairly decent point because some of them do carry toxins. But if you're talking about human beings, either gender of human beings, then terms like toxic are clearly hyperbolic and require an explanation. No decent explanation has been given. Can we talk about things in terms of things that actually apply to human beings?
You know, it's really funny about this to me. And I mean, this is actually funny, haha. I went to a small college for a couple of years that was more of a private school, and it was a school anybody could go to, but it was run, and it was started and run by the Mennonite Church. You didn't have to be Mennonite to go there. You didn't have to live like a Mennonite to go there, although it was a dry campus, and there was no smoking on campus. But there was a thing that we all had to go to as freshmen. It was called Forum. And you only went once a week, and it was for an hour, and you had to sign for attendance. And if you could miss a lot of them, but you had to go to a certain number of hours of it every year in order to be able to graduate up to a certain number of years. And I think it was just freshmen and sophomores. But a lot of the students went as much as they could. And it really, they didn't say this, but it was about learning good character. And it wasn't geared towards gender. It wasn't geared towards religion. It wasn't geared towards any characteristic, any demographic. But it was about being a functional person in modern society in a way that would be helpful to other people and helpful to yourself, would make your life easier. You know, the things that I remember watching and listening to, every single one of them was about developing the characteristics and the habits as a person that were going to help you succeed in things that you wanted to do later in life, like having a better job or being part of a neighborhood without having everybody hate you for being there. You know, just normal human things. Mm-hmm. And stuff like that, like feminists hate stuff like that. They hate that stuff because it's very often attached to religion. And it's not necessarily a religious thing. You don't have to be religious to want to be a better person. You don't have to be, in fact, you don't have to be not religious to be a bad person. I've met some religious people who were wonderful and some religious people who I never want to see again in my life. But this was geared towards, you know, at a time when you're developing your adult self, helping you to develop a better adult self. Well, this toxic masculinity shit is exactly the opposite. It's not about character building. It's about tearing the person down. It's not about helping them find community with their neighbors and learn skills or even just habits that'll help them in their job later in life. It's about telling men that they can't be good people and still be rugged. You know, it's about telling men that if they have wants and needs, that they must be hurting someone. And telling men that if they care about themselves, that they're being selfish towards somebody else without even considering that maybe they're caring about themselves last. Without even considering that maybe some men are naturally rugged, and that ruggedness doesn't necessarily translate into violence. Mm-hmm. I know, and this is kind of ridiculous. You know, it's one thing to advocate that men should not be required to be rugged to be considered men, that they don't have to meet some stereotype in order to be considered men. But it's an entirely different thing to say that they can't be considered men because they meet that stereotype, that that's immaturity or there's something wrong with them or they're evil or bad for being the stereotype. That stereotype came from somewhere, you know, and it's not something that was necessarily imposed on all men. But it's just as wrong to tell men that they can't be themselves if themselves happen to be something other than the shape that feminists are trying to mold them into, as it is to tell men they can't be themselves if themselves happens to be different than the shape that society tries to mold them into to be utilitarian.
Yep. Anybody else want to say anything?
Oh, sorry, the contrast of that just kind of blew my mind.
Yeah. All right, let's go on to the next thing. I'm also trying to get Dave in here. I think he said he wanted to come on, so I'm going to try and get him a link.
Who's Dave?
Computing Forever?
Dave's not here, man.
Huh?
Computing Forever?
Dave's not here, Forever man. Wants to come in?
Yeah, he was in the chat. I said, do you want to come on? And he said, yep, unless he's responding to somebody else. That's the thing. It's hard to tell.
That's another one I can.
He just came off the Bering stream. I was on that stream as well. Which is like the third stream we'll have both been on in the past 3 hours. It's been a strange night so far.
Damn, Mike, you're popular.
Well, no, he's in the chat. He says, stream me up, Buttercup.
All right, well, I just...
All right, Scotty.
Let me see. I'm going to try and find him. Hold on.
I have to go in a couple minutes.
I can't multiply the things. I need more limbs. I need more limbs, guys. Why can't I have more limbs?
You should have been an octopus instead of a doge.
I know.
Then you could carry all these limes. Nobody can carry all these limes.
No. See, the thing is, Dave, I can only... Wait, are you on Skype? Because if I send it to you via Twitter, I can only send it to you in a tweet, which means we'll get a bunch of dicks, too. And we don't want dicks.
No, I can do it. He's followed me.
Hang all right, on, give him the link. But don't do it through Twitter. Do it through a private messaging thing.
Yeah, otherwise, yeah I know.
Okay. Bering's giving me flashbacks.
He's got this under control, though.
All right, so...
I've been suckered by too many dicks before. You're telling me I don't know dick?
All right, so in the meantime, we'll look at Portlandia a little bit. So if you've never seen this show, you really should. I like the feminist bookstore bits. They're very funny. In other words, that's the name of the actual bookstore instead of women. I think Women and Women First is actually a better name, but, you know, whatever. They use some interesting language, and they say, fuck Portlandia, transmisogyny, racism, gentrification, queer antagonism, devaluation of feminist discourse. Let's look at these things, all right? So, transmisogyny. So the show is headed up by two people, Fred Armisen and another woman whose name I don't remember. Call me a sexist if you want, I just don't. And they play basically the main characters in about every skit. Sometimes that means they cross-dress, and sometimes they do that for fun. For example, one of the other popular characters is a couple. They're like a married couple, and one of them is this guy named Lance, who's extremely masculine. He drives muscle cars, and he wears Dago t-shirts. He has a mustache and a ponytail. You know, he curses a lot, whatever. And his girlfriend is extremely feminine. And to make that skit funnier, they actually play each, you know, the female plays the male character, and the man plays the female character. It's not trans misogyny just because someone is cross-dressing for comedic effect, especially when the main characters, the main actors rather, is one man and one woman, and they just play whatever characters they need to. So I find that that's really, I don't know where you get trans misogyny from just because people are cross-dressing. Blair and Theron, if you're listening, can you please help out? Not that, you know, you guys are the ultimate arbiter on this, but I don't see the logic here that this bookstore is presenting, which kind of makes it laughable.
If that is the case, if we're going to follow that logic, does that mean that Sheldon from the Big Bang Theory, the way they portray him, is that prejudiced against autistic people?
Or against gays because the actor is gay but the character isn't? Or is the character gay now? I don't watch the show, but...
Yeah, well, he's gay in a pejorative sense. I don't know about the homosexual sense.
Oh.
Well, I don't know. I don't like the Big Bang Theory.
That's why I watched like the first couple seasons of the show, and it just got old real fast. And it's not really... It's a good portrayal of how other people see nerds.
Mm-hmm.
It's not really a good portrayal of nerds. But it's probably popular in part because everybody feels like a nerd sometimes, and so they all like the fact that there are characters portraying nerds. But you could, in a way, say that if you wanted to get butthurt, if you want to take the feminist route, you could say the entire show is an insult to all things nerd and geek, and get up in arms about that, too. I just got tired of watching it, and, you know, I don't watch a lot of TV anyway. But I think the same thing is going on here as would be going on if nerds did that with regard to that show. They have identified that a male is playing a female character, and they've called it transmisogyny. But mm-hmm. I'm like looking up a definition for this, and it's really kind of hard. It's like patriarchy. You can't nail it down. I suppose saying nailing transmisogyny probably that's, counts as transmisogyny
that's
too.
That's also rape culture. Kind of.
Yes, but something that comes up in Google says, transmisogyny is an intersection of two forms of oppression that transgender women are subjected to, transphobia and misogyny. So that doesn't help, because I don't know what makes it unique from misogyny without it this defining it as unique from other misogyny being transphobic. I think the word transphobia might actually, or transmisogyny might actually be a transphobic term.
What's the fundamental difference, do you think?
Between what?
Well,
someone who's transitioned from male to female experiencing misogyny versus someone who is a natal female.
None, really.
Well, first of all, I don't think that a lot of the, wherever you stand on whether or not a person can be trans, most of the flack that men who believe that they're women or who transition to presenting as women get is because they're men, or they're perceived to be men by the greater society. And they're perceived to have shirked their duties as men to women. In the most fundamental way, and appropriated those kinds of privileges that women get, which is provision and protection.
In particular, feminists, right, in terms of how they see them when they've transitioned.
Yeah, at least trans-exclusive feminists, if you want to split multiple.
I'm sure there's a portion of every sort of all kinds of places in society where they don't like trans people, but only in feminism do they get their own particular name that legitimizes it. They're called TERFs.
Yes, and if you run them over, you get turf toe. it strikes me that the use of the term transmisogyny itself is transphobic, because it's separating trans women out from other women.
Yep.
And well, if these intersectional feminists have to have a separate category for trans women apart from other women, and a separate category for them being oppressed, apart from other women being oppressed, but it's a category that they term misogyny, and they can't have the same misogyny that other women supposedly have, are they really accepted in that community? You know, now, that's not to disparage what Allison said. Allison's point is a really great point, because the truth is, what's being described there is not misogyny, it's misandry.
Well, it's the expectation that men be held to a certain standard of behavior, and if they don't, they should be subject to physical punishment.
Right.
I just popped in because I wanted to totally bring this stream to excessive critical mass of people on it. Is Portlandia the last item that you're talking about, or do you have another one?
We have two more.
Yeah.
Are you here to crack the whip?
I may be cracking the whip a bit.
Because more people doesn't actually make the shows go faster.
No, I know.
Okay.
I'm probably...
Right. Can you pick something I may have heard of?
Yeah, let's...
Well, we're done with... I don't think there's anything else to say about Portlandia. It's a joke, because... And the only thing I wanted to say is that, you know, what's going to happen if we were to follow this sort of behavior and reaction to acting to its ultimate logical conclusion, according to these kinds of people? Actors can never portray anything other than what they are. And that's the only place where this can go. So it's your event, and inevitably you're going to get to places where, you know, straight people can't play gays in film because that's homophobic, because they should just hire gay actors, or people can't play people that have, you know, that are from different nations, that have different accents, because that's nationalist or something. This is just... It seems like this is the only place where this can go when you actually, if you were to actually give ground to these kinds of griefers. So
Serene McKellen was quite happy to play a straight man on numerous occasions, and to play a father as well, I seem to recall.
Oh, yeah, sure. Most of the time,
the jury's out on that.
Most of the time is the case, but you know, Fred Armisen, he cross dresses to play a female character, and everyone freaks out. Because that's really what they're talking about. Although I don't know what queer antagonism is, I do know what devaluation of feminist discourse is. And hey, you know what? If you guys had better ideas, it probably wouldn't be so easy to do. But that
the buzzing.
Yeah, there's not really anything valuable about feminist discourse unless you're looking for something to start to point with value, and laugh at.
And then it devalues. That's how it works. You know,
but because of minority identity politics, it will always be easier for the minority, either the gay person or the trans person, to play somebody of the majority. So yes. Dan Mahoney in Dan in Real Life is a gay man, but he can play a straight man, for example. And you will have a trans person playing a cis person, but you will never have it the other way around, unfortunately, because of the climate we live in.
Yes.
And no matter how big shot the Hollywood actor is, you can always get them playing a mental or a retard, but you'll never get it the other way around.
So. No.
Oh. Okay.
All right. So now we'll move on to the next story. All right. So Playboy. So just to go through this a little bit, the Playboy magazine has featured an article about a hijab-wearing Muslim American, Noor Taghouri, making a forceful case for modesty. Yes, you read that correctly. It's in its October Renegades issue, Playboy is showcasing a religious conservative practice as emblematic of an independent woman. And I found this to be really, really interesting because, well, one thing I want to say about Playboy, again, I know that there are people who say RIP Playboy, good riddance, whatever, because, you know, it's sort of like in the marketplace of ideas, I guess, or in the marketplace, not necessarily marketplace of ideas, in the general marketplace, Playboy can't compete with the internet. What it once offered that was sort of unique to itself in magazine form, which are basically nudes and good articles, now you can find at least the nudes online. Good articles, however, a lot more difficult. So that being the case, it would make sense that Playboy as a company would sort of like run into financial problems and have to make changes to maintain its relevance. However, I do think that the fact that Hugh Hefner's daughter, who is an identifying feminist, took over the rag, and now it is completely shifted, and they talk about social justice topics, they no longer have nudes, and then to take it to the next level, they bring on, as an example of what it means to be a kick-ass woman that is punching up and like liberating, you have a woman wearing a hijab who is essentially making a case for modesty in Playboy.
Right, Brian, you're talking about Noor Taghouri, is that correct?
That's right, Noor Taghouri.
Right, yes. So I'm very, if this is the sign of things to come as the establishment that once was Playboy, I'm going to download all of the porn off the internet now because this is deeply concerning for me.
Mm-hmm. And here's the thing, wasn't Playboy I don't want to say a male space per se, because it's not entirely accurate. I mean, actually, my first exposure to Playboy was through a lesbian mother of one of my best friends who had a large Playboy collection. But it was a place where men would, you know, it was a man's magazine. That was what it was for, you know, and it had nudes and it had, like, articles and it had other stuff. It was all, like, it was man stuff in there. What the hell happened to it?
Playboy was about catering to men's interests. Yes. There was no doubt about that. It was specifically towards catering to men's interests. And this is a full frontal assault on men being allowed to have something catered to their interests. We just got told that it hurts women for something to cater to men's interest, even if there are women who want to participate and it's all above board and nobody's agency is being denied in the course of it and everybody is getting to make their own choices and anybody that wants to say no can say no. If men's interests of any kind are being served here, it's hurtful to women, and a woman has to come in and tell all you guys that there needs to be a case to end it.
It's just social justice invading everything, like video games.
Mm-hmm. You'd think the first places they'd invade would be the lad magazines like Nuts and Zoo, but no, the first places they got to were Playboy and GQ. What does that tell you?
Can I point something out here? What's really interesting is that you have a situation where there's a certain class of women, and this seems to happen throughout history, who, when you give sexual freedom in general, or you encourage like a more of a sexually free society, those women, in partnership, with male producers, they end up serving I wouldn't say like is a bad thing, but they end up becoming entertainers, sexual entertainers. They end up making a lot of money, and then you get this prudish group of women who let's say aren't quite as entertaining or quite as beautiful, and they want to shut that shit down. And what ends up happening is this: they start promoting these kinds of obscenity laws, modesty laws. They start promoting the idea that women, a respectable woman, doesn't wear stuff like that. And it's so interesting because I've seen this throughout history. This competition between women who are sexual entertainers and the prudish women who are jealous of the attention that they get, of the money that they make, and who end up shutting them down. And what ends up happening is the prudish women make themselves out to be victims of the situation, and then they pair up with male politicians to sign in laws to prevent women from engaging in this kind of free sexual expression. And so it's going to, at some point, feminists are going to probably influence male politicians to sign in feminist obscenity laws. And then generations from now, we will be enforcing, there will be male security officers enforcing these obscenity laws on everyone else. And we'll have forgotten where the fuck they came from. And then men will be blamed once again for taking away the boobs.
Mm-hmm. It's Puritanism. At the end of the day, it helps to facilitate the Islamization of the West in a major way. I've always said it. The feminist hardcores in this instance have much more in common with Islamists than people give them credit for.
Absolutely. Oh, actually, that was the thing I was just going to mention is that, like, we're looking at a magazine, and you know, this is why I find the Playboy thing particularly interesting. We're looking at a magazine that has had nudes in it since its inception. And in fact, when it began, and I think like Marilyn Monroe was like on one of the very first ones, if not the very first one, the nudity was actually far more modest back then, because back then it was like in the 40s or the 50s or whenever it came out, that was considered like, whoa, super edgy. And as we moved through like the 60s, when things were a lot more sexualized, then the Playboy magazine always evolved with the times, obviously, because it needed to remain relevant. But it's never been as regressive as it is now. Since its inception, it hasn't become the way it is now. Now, there are no more nudes, and the people say that it's because, you know, you can get them on the internet, but I don't think so, because, we've had the internet for a while, plus we've had magazines that are far dirtier that you could get if you really wanted to. You can go get Hustler or Cherry or Penthouse or whatever. So, but Playboy always remained relevant and always made good money. So I don't think it's really a market force, per se. I think there is something political and ideological that's happening within not only Playboy, but many other magazines as well. It's just the fact that it's affecting Playboy makes it stand out, especially with this latest photo shoot. And I want to read a little bit from this article that's from the Playboy.com website, where they ask Noor, at what point do you feel like you've succeeded in affecting change, which apparently she wants to do because she wants to become the first female anchor to wear a hijab on American television. She says, I will have succeeded in affecting change when all girls realize they can do anything they want without having to sacrifice who they are as a person. I may dress a little different. I'm a reporter who happens to wear a headscarf, and I live in my hoodie. But being a storyteller, motivational speaker, entrepreneur, and unapologetically myself has opened so many doors for thousands of people.
Fuck this. You know, this stuff annoys me, Brian. I'm sorry. But okay. This business of I haven't sacrificed anything. You don't even realize what you've sacrificed in order to be a woman or a human being. The very fact that you have actually been encouraged to wear that fucking hijab in the first place. You don't have any individuality. You sacrificed it a long time ago.
Now, there's another aspect of this that, you know, I don't think this, it just doesn't sound to me at all like her reason for wanting to be the first woman to wear a hijab as a news anchor. It doesn't feel to me like she's doing that because she feels oppressed here in the United States as a woman.
Well, she doesn't feel that way, obviously.
It's not about her. But it's not about her gender, is it? It's about shoving her religion in other people's faces.
Sure.
This is, I mean, I like I said, I don't care if she were to just do it. you know, without saying, I got to do this. I'm going to be the first person to do this. This is so important.
Look at me doing
this.
Just
go into the profession, right? Become a reporter. Just do it and get it over with and just be there because your statement is being there, right? But if she has to sit there and get a Playboy centerfold or whatever and talk about how she's breaking barriers and all that, I don't see any difference between that and the idiot that came to my door the other day trying to tell me that I needed to invite a 2,000-year dead guy into my life. Like, I've had evangelists come to my door before. I had one lady that wouldn't stop coming back until I ridiculed her. And when I did that, I was really kind of mean. I talked to her with a stuffed animal instead of talking to her myself. But it was after she came back repeatedly after being told not to come back. So I get really annoyed with that shit. I get annoyed with people, with door-to-door salesmen. You know, the people come to my door that want me to change power companies every couple of weeks. You know, I don't want that. If I want to go to church, I'll go to church. If I don't want to go to church, coming to my door and telling me that I need to go to church isn't going to get me there. It's going to get the door slammed in your face. And
my
so
worry
is,
it's a little bit more serious than Jehovah's Witnesses who have absolutely zero power whatsoever. My problem
well,
is...
Well, no, this is Jehovah's Witnesses. This would be like if Jehovah's Witnesses could go to your local city council and tell your city council that you're oppressing them if you don't agree to come to their church.
If there's already an Islamist takeover of Playboy, which we're already seeing an Islamist takeover of the West, I mean, I'm kind of deeply concerned about this. This is another death of Western culture by another shallow cut.
I did actually put my name in, so I did want to address some stuff. The thing is with what I'm seeing with the criticism of Islam is that it fails to recognize the effect or the power that women have to perpetuate that particular death cult in our society, and to inoculate other people into it. I would hesitate to say that she is necessarily brainwashed. She probably does feel that it is, whatever, liberating. And if we fail to recognize the effect of these groups of incredibly prudish, puritanical women. Oh, and they aren't actually the politicians, and they aren't the lawmakers, and they're not the people who are going to enforce them, but they will influence all of those people, all of those men, into creating these laws that reduce and confine women's freedoms, because they don't like the fact that when you give women as a group freedom, there are women who win bigger, and there are women who lose bigger. I mean, when you give women sexual freedom, when you create things like the beauty ideal. You create the ability for a woman to make millions off of her beauty when you give them sexual freedom, that sexual freedom. And what is going to drive taking that sexual freedom away from women in the West is not Western men. I don't even think it's Islamist men. It's going to be women like this. And they're going to make friends with feminists who will eventually realize that the only way to take away thin privilege, to take away beauty privilege, to take away the beauty ideal is to hide women who have those privileges.
It's a little bit more complicated than that, Allison. I mean, at the end of the day, yes, those women believe that, but it's because they've internalized the misogynistic value system of the institution that they have consumed and been brainwashed into.
This is why it's important to know the huge difference between a burqa and a hijab. Very few of us are in any doubt that the women who wear burqas, for the most part, do not choose to wear burqas. But can you see, at least now, why the women who wear hijabs absolutely choose unilaterally to wear hijabs?
And it's any of you guys, have any of you guys ever been to Fort Knox?
No.
You ever see it in movies, on television, see?
Sure.
Like, Escape to Witch Mountain, I think, or Return from Witch Mountain or something had a moment with, I think it was Fort Knox, where they took all the gold out of Fort Knox. But if you actually go into Fort Knox, or even if you go into a museum, and there's a display in the museum that's particularly valuable. You ever notice that you can't touch it? That not just that there's a sign that says don't touch this, but it's behind glass. And in Fort Knox, the gold is behind bulletproof glass, and there's all kinds of alarms, and there's all kinds of guards in there with guns, and you can't get your ass close to it, you know. When you protect something, when you cover something, when you make something unavailable, It's not always necessarily because it's considered bad or sinful or shameful. We don't think gold is bad or sinful or shameful. We don't think it's ugly. We don't hate gold. And I think in this instance, there is a dual issue here. Because women in many societies react to discussion about modesty as if we are being told that we are shameful and ugly and dirty and shouldn't be seen, when the truth is more often than not, it is because we are on that pedestal, that one that we don't want to fall off of, right? The one that so many women who benefit from being on the pedestal fight tooth and nail to not even allow other women to come down off of.
That's that right? Woman looking at this situation from a very westernized lens. But that's in most of the Middle East.
No. See, the same thing was said about women in the East. And this is my point. And I've had to say this to people, mostly in private messages on Twitter, because it's just Twitter's not long enough for a full rant on this. But feminism plus Islam is going to spell absolute disaster. Because there is a value to women in Islam. And this woman is putting it on display, and people are missing it. She's the wedge. Just like feminism was the wedge in the United States to get in between human beings in the United States and our due process rights by demonizing men as sexual predators. Feminism was the wedge that pried that apart, that started making it easier and easier for people to give up on having the right to introduce exculpatory evidence against your accuser's story in a court case if the accuser was embarrassed to talk about, you know, her history and things like that. That's the wedge. This is the wedge. This is doing exactly the same thing from a different angle.
All that content that you're talking about and this co-option by feminists of magazines like Playboy, for example, and the way in which it's written, that's all very appealing for feminists who are butt ugly. And I get that. I really do. But at the end of the day, I just look at a country like Iran. And they tried to resist the hijab and the burqa for a very long time, and they failed. And I think the very same thing will happen in the West if we're not too careful. But there's going to be too much resistance.
The thing is, women like this that will come in with these, you know, stories that sound nice to feminists about how this represents self-respect and how it represents the freedom to avoid, you know, and they'll use their buzzwords, objectification, blah, blah, blah. Women like this are the ones that are the salesmen. This is Islam's door-to-door salesman to feminist housewives. This is how to persuade feminists to accept incrementally little bits of freedom being taken away. And unfortunately, in the West, feminists have a great deal of power already. They have a great deal of influence on law and policy.
If those Islamist laws get in place, it'll be because of the feminists influencing the politicians.
Well, that's just it. This is the wedge. This is what I'm saying. They're going to get these women, these feminist women, not the Gloria Steinems, but the Jigglypuffs or Trigglypuffs or whatever her name was of you know, our universities, of our neighborhoods and everything to start pressuring their politicians and their university administrations.
Not long term, though. Their numbers are too low. Their support numbers are too low. And we already know the next generation are more conservative than this one. I think feminism has already reached a critical mass in terms of its level of interest and influence.
I don't think so.
I think it's us a little bit too close to the situation. You are absolutely right to be concerned. I admire that. I really do. I mean, we should be that little bit paranoid about the situation, but I don't think they're in any way as influential
actually,
as they are.
I think we should be a lot paranoid about it. And the reason I think we should be a lot paranoid about it is kind of embodied in the fight between men's rights activists and feminists on parenting rights. How many states have had fathers' groups introduce equally shared parenting legislation where the state of the legislation would be in uncontested cases, or you know, where nobody is saying, I want custody and I don't want the other person to have custody, just uncontested cases where they were just going to go with the default, that it would be 50-50. And had the National Organization for Women torpedo it by lying to legislators, saying it was an every case imperative, demonizing fathers as deadbeats and abusers, and demanding on women's behalf, without women ever going in there and saying, no, we don't want this, you know, demanding on women's behalf that they torpedo those laws. It's almost every state has had one. It's happened in the same way in Canada. So they're still in power. And they're still influenced by a university feminist. They're still influenced by feminist academia. That network is still there. And what we're just seeing now is somebody's plugging into the network and looking for a place to spread their virus.
All right, yeah, the moment feminism loses traction might simply be the moment where the Islamic model sort of gets the torch passed to it, so to speak, because it's always been a battle of political correctness, and political correctness is basically boils down to whoever is most protective over women, and the big players in the fight have always been Islam and feminism and traditional gynocentrism, whatever your country or your region's traditional gynocentrism is. And that traditional gynocentrism was defeated in the last century, so now it's fight to the finish between Islam and feminism, and it looks like Islam is going to take it, unless we do away with this battle altogether.
Yeah, but it's like what Lenin said. I mean, it's exactly the reason we are where we are. I mean, it's like you change the minds of women, and very, very quickly you'll change the minds of men as well, because men will always congregate where women are. You know, we're not. The future is difficult to predict because we're failing to predict change. That the winds of change will change anyway. We've already reached a critical mass with this discussion. We already have platforms with which we debunk this stuff every day, and there's more and more women coming out against feminism. I actually think the next 5 years you're going to see a very significant change against all of this anyway. So I'd be a little bit more hopeful than perhaps we are on this stream right now. Maybe it's the 7 pints I've had right now, but I don't see it. I really fucking don't. I don't. I think there's too many women out who are jaded of this.
We're at the fork in the road. We're at the crossroads, and we're trying to figure out which is the worst road and which is the second worst road. You know.
Mike, it's very easy to create a very bleak picture if you want to. It's not difficult. We can do that all night if you'd like. But there's too many smart women and smart men who are competing against us, and I don't see it. I really don't. I don't think it's going to be that bad, honestly. I think we have a rising conservative movement now online and in politics, and this is not going to happen.
Here's what I see. You remember at the end of the Hobbit when there's 5 different armies fighting over the gold?
Yeah.
You know, and we've got, like, you think of it as you know, the different groups of people, and you've got the goblins, and the goblins are the feminists. Okay. And of course David Fitrell will have fun with that. Hannibal, feminist goblins. Well, the goblins are the feminists, and screw you, Fitrell. But in any case, what we've got now is somebody going, well, the goblins don't have that big of an army. We don't have to worry about the goblins.
And then somebody else going,
oh my God, the goblins are really going to get us. The goblins are going to... Well, what our problem is we need to get in the middle of that, in between the goblins, the goblin army and shrinking, and the goblin army is a threat, and say, okay, well, in case the goblin army is a threat, we need to be armed against it, and we need to be vigilant of the goblin army. We don't absolutely have to panic because, over the goblin army.
Look, the eternal price of freedom is vigilance, absolutely. And I'm not underestimating their power or influence at all. But it is waning. We have to understand that. There's so much cynicism. It's not popular or cool or in any way. This is why you see any lipstick feminism take to YouTube and produce a video with their webcam. And she always has to justify herself for the first 5 minutes going, why is feminism such a dirty word? And we know why, because it's been debunked a billion times. It's not popular because it won't be popular again. Social justice,
but it keeps
is
coming back.
Shit, and it's been debunked. And the longer it goes on, the more the next generation. Do you know what one of the most popular new genres? I mean, 2 years ago, the most popular new genre of content on YouTube was ASMR videos. Right, it was new. You know the most popular call out culture now. pwnage videos. The young generation of 15, 16-year-olds ripping on feminists. That is the new big thing that young kids are doing. And the more it becomes taboo to do it, the more there's censorship, the more there's demonetization, there's more there's flag videos, the more they're going to want to do it, the more they're going to gravitate to other platforms where they're going to want to do it. Feminism has had its day, and in 2 years' time, we probably won't be having the same conversation. I guarantee
you. Yeah, but the social justice attitude behind it will come back.
Well,
this is not something that is going to go away forever because of one defeat. It never has in the past, and it probably never will.
No, it won't.
This is a battle we'll have to fight over and over again. And that's
cultural
what I'm saying.
Marxism will have numerous different forms.
I'm not even talking about cultural Marxism. I'm talking about a human behavior. Before it was that, it was racism. Mm-hmm. Before it was racism, it was something else. You know, there will always be something. What I'm talking about is we have to keep watch when this kind of behavior, when we see somebody that can't just do their thing, and they've got to act like they're doing it because they're a victim of society. You know, and they've got to play the underdog, and they've got to create that threat narrative. What are they trying to sell you? And that's what you always got to watch for. And it's not about whether feminism is winning or losing. It's not about whether Islam is evil or good or something in between. You know, and as far as religion is concerned, I have no problem with people practicing their religion. I have a problem with people telling me I got to accept it or be part of it, or that if I don't do something for them, that I'm oppressing them. And that's what's going on here with Islam now. You know, go to your whatever kind of church it is. Go to your church, live your life, be yourself, do your thing. That's fine, but don't tell me that I'm oppressing you because I don't do it too.
I just look at it from a pure numbers game. You know, the numbers are going to be on our side in the next few years. And like I say, there's too many far-right parties growing. There's the alt-right is a relative new movement. Long-term, these things, when they become the establishment, it becomes trendy to kick against them. So I have a lot of faith in the next generation, Generation mm-hmm. Z or whatever.
I appreciate your optimism, but there's no reason to...
Lord knows this channel is Mike.
Vigilance is necessary, even if you're optimistic. Surely,
all right.
Yeah, vigilant optimism is a good way to put it, and a good way to go.
Yeah, I want to give
absolutely.
Allison had her name in for a while, so I want to give Allison the chance to say something about this.
Before Allison goes, I'm gonna run myself. But thanks very much for having me, and I'll talk to you guys.
You're not gonna talk to us about the teen boy that got arrested. On the next story, where he was like he was an Arab boy that was on YouTube with a girl and got arrested for unethical behavior.
Send me the link. I'd love to hear more about it, but I'm gonna have to run, unfortunately, okay. Guys. It's very late here.
Oh, no problem. Have a nice night.
Thanks. See ya.
Okay, I actually disappeared from the stream for a while there, and I see Max is gone too.
He had to go. That happens.
Yeah. Okay, well, I didn't really have much to say, so why don't we go on to the next topic?
You didn't want
to
talk about Tour Nur Tuguri or anything like that, no?
Nope, that's good.
Okay, so last topic, teen boy in Saudi Arabia arrested for unethical behavior after a flirty chat with a YouTube teen girl star. Abu Sin, that's his name, which means toothless, and Christina Crockett, I guess she's some really famous YouTuber, probably because she's cute, jokingly declared their love for one another in a silly YouTube now stream that has since been uploaded. They struggled through language barriers and acted like goofy young people. Evidently, being a cute kid is a crime in Saudi Arabia, where the 19-year-old internet goofball lives. A Saudi attorney told Okaz newspaper the videos violate the country's interpretation of Sharia law and internet regulations. Abu Sin could face up to 3 years in prison. This video captures a moment in which he was arrested, which doesn't show you anything, and it's also filmed in another language. So, police in, I can't pronounce this, Riyadh. Abu Sin on Sunday while he was driving with two friends, with the arrest accidentally broadcast live on YouNow as he chatted with another user from Kuwait. The footage showed police pulling up behind the car and the teenager approaching officers before friends tell the camera police have an arrest warrant, according to a translation by France 24. Colonel Fawaz Al-Maiman, a spokesperson for Riyadh police, said Abu Sin was arrested for unethical behavior. His videos received many comments, and many of the commenters of the general public demanded for him to be punished for his actions, he added, according to the Saudi Gazette. This is not the first time the Saudi internet user has been arrested, or a Saudi internet user has been arrested for videos that the authorities deem immoral. In 2013, another young man was arrested by the religious police after he posted photos of himself offering free hugs in the streets of Riyadh. So that's basically the short version of this story. So apparently there's a boy that is now in prison because he hung out with a girl on YouTube. I wonder if the YouTube girl knew that she was putting him in danger. I mean, I wonder if he knew too, not to pretend that, you know, that wasn't a thing.
I think he wouldn't have known because they're pretty strict, but he was a kid, right? I mean, 19 is still pretty kiddish.
I'm going to lower it.
I guess it depends on where you are and how you live. If he was at a lower income level, he might not have been very kiddish at that age. But I wonder, when they say unethical, what the hell would be unethical about talking to a person on YouTube? Is it, if it's just because she's female, is it...
Really strict behavioral laws there. Like, this is... there should be no fraternization between any unmarried female and unmarried male who's not related to her, period. So, yeah, I could... Having lived there for 10 years, I could see why they would say this is so-called unethical.
But what's interesting, he's arrested for that.
Well, she, which means American, it's, so
right.
He's American.
But I mean, he's arrested for that, which means if it was a girl there, he would still be arrested, right? Not just her.
Yes. Yes.
So it's for protection of both of them, from, you know, under this mindset, obviously, from some sort of temptation, probably.
Yeah, it's an argument for modesty. I mean, it's a law against modesty. I'm sorry.
A law in support of their over modest behavior. So essentially, this is that totalitarian social micromanagement.
Could it be because she's
authoritarian social micromanagement that I was talking about before?
Could it be more severe because she's not? Well, first off, probably not a Muslim, definitely not Arab, a white girl from America. Could she's showing some cleavage. Could those things also be a part of it?
Well, it's a weird sort of situation because usually they do give a bit more latitude towards women who, not women who are necessarily of a lower class, which would be like South Asian, Asian, Filipino, Pakistani, or any of the other women that they import as slave labor. But white women tend to be perceived almost like a higher class, at least when you're not talking about the ones who are, you know, into the whole infidel religious persecution shit. So they may give her, well, they obviously have no jurisdiction over her. So
what about him? Are they considering him to have committed a bigger crime because he spoke to somebody that they would consider an infidel, somebody that's a bad influence, basically an outsider?
Probably, you know, from what and this is just conjecture on my part, probably it would have been worse if he had talked to a Saudi woman or a Saudi girl, because then he would probably have been brought up on charges of, might have been brought up on charges of related to adultery.
Okay.
So it's sort of difficult to say, but yeah, he's fucked.
So that strikes me as there being less protection of him and more protection of the female.
Well, okay.
And because of that, more restriction of the female in some ways, but he would have been the bad guy in a scenario if he'd have been talking to an
unmarried, you know, Saudi woman.
Well, she would also have been punished as well.
Right, she'd have been punished as well.
It's from what I've seen of the statistics, the only statistics that I've seen in terms of like stoning, since the 90s, they've recorded more men who have been victims of stoning than women. And just having listened to broadcasts about crime in the Middle East through the BBC and also like local broadcasts when I was there, it tended to be like, for example, One example would be something that happened in Bahrain, where a woman married a man, it was Afghanistan. A woman married a man, and who her father didn't approve of. So he got them charged. They both charged with adultery, basically. And she was in jail for 5 years, but she was able to see her family. So she was able to see her son. He was in jail for 10 years, and it was a jail where he couldn't see, he wasn't allowed visitation. And it's stuff like that. It's sort of subtle stuff like that that makes me believe, and there's no, I have no statistics to base this on, that in general, they are just like us. They punish men more harshly than women. But I could be wrong. Like, I have no statistics to base that on. In our culture, we do have statistics that show that we punish women or less harshly than men.
But the hard thing is that there's not a lot of information coming out of there that's necessarily readable to everybody that only reads English. So, like, people like me, I'm not going to be able to see anything that doesn't make it to Western sites, or that if you put it through Google Translate, it's not necessarily, it comes through in this sort of garbled English that doesn't always, you can't make sense of it. It's so garbled that the words don't put together, you know, don't come together to make any kind of complete sentences or anything. It doesn't translate well at all. So there's only a few cases I've seen where you see a guy and a girl from the same area that get in trouble. But everything that I've seen is just like you've said, when both of them get punished, he gets punished more harshly. And I've seen the same thing with cases where there's apostasy of some type.
Oh yeah,
it's like men getting crucified. I haven't found a single case online. I'm sure somebody could probably send me one if there's any that exist, but I haven't seen a single story that's been translated into English of a woman getting crucified.
Somebody in the chat named Barry M. Deep is saying that this is nuance. So actually recognizing that men are victims is nuance. So we're actually apologizing for Islam by recognizing that men are victims of Islam. You need
are you
to
kidding?
Step back. And think about what you have just said, Barry. You have just said that by recognizing men are victims of something, you are apologizing for it. You are excusing it. In what universe are people recognizing that men are victims, excusing the thing that they're victimized by?
You think about this. God. If we look at this only in terms of the things that they're doing to women, and the things that they're doing to women get alleviated to a degree, and you have it combined with this feminist push for acceptance. So it reaches a point where feminists say, okay, you've alleviated the terrible things they're doing to women to a degree that we're willing to accept the entire religion. Let's bring it on, bring it into the West. And they bring it into the West, and they haven't alleviated the terrible things that they do to men.
Oh, but Barry will be okay with that.
We will be bringing crucifixion for saying no to a religion into the West.
But no, you know what? People like Barry will be okay with that. If we resolved all of the issues, if we gave Islamic women the same or the same freedom as Islamic men, but we gave them the same freedom as Western women, but we just kept all men under the same restrictions, the same stonings, cutting your hand off, being charged with being an infidel. We just keep the restrictions on men. Then Islam is okay. Then it's fine. Let's bring it on in, right? Let's bring it on in. Oh. Okay, anyway.
See, that's what we did in the West. This is exactly what I've been trying to talk to people about on Twitter. In the West, in our history, okay, you look back at coverture, you look back at all of the laws that governed relationships and money making, who was going to be the breadwinner of the family, what women could or couldn't do, what men could or couldn't do, and what men could or couldn't do with respect to women. The requirements that men faced, the obligations that men have, and the restrictions on men's behavior with respect to women. Feminists fought tooth and nail to maintain those while they were alleviating women, you know, women's restrictions, while they were relieving women of their obligations, where they were relieving women of their restrictions and their requirements for their behavior. So now we have a situation where fathers are being kicked out of their homes and they're being kept away from their children and they're being made homeless due to child support obligations, and women can rule their entire workplace by going to human resources and saying, some guy looked at my ass, you know. Now we have this situation where it's almost not safe for a guy to go to university because he never knows when he's going to get a false accusation against him that will get him kicked out of school and kept from going to another school, and he'll still have to pay all of his college loans, and he'll never have that career that he was going for. You know, this is where alleviating women's issues, this is where addressing only women's restrictions and only women's obligations gets us. And that's just in Western society, where things were never quite, well, I shouldn't say never, but not in the last several centuries were things as anywhere near as bad for either gender as they are in under Islam, under an Islamic, extreme Islamic theocracy. You know, we don't have that situation.
All right, can I just interject here? I've talked, and I'm not going to give any update, any like names or anything, but I talked to someone about, or who actually was at least partially involved in helping people who were basically in the U.S. or in the U.S. and Canada, or Canada, dealing with being targeted, that having a fatwa on their head, and these people were majority male. Now that's another thing, that another data point, and it's anecdotal, so we don't know, but that's another data point that you can put into whether or not this stuff is facing men more. Are the punishments in this religion are inflicted on men more? And it, you know what? It doesn't fucking matter at the end of the day, because it is an oppressive religion.
Well, I'll tell you what matters to me is that that means that when we see all these news stories that come out, and the news media only cares about this stuff when it happens to women, we see these news stories come out, we may be only seeing the tip of the iceberg. We may be seeing the last little sliver of brutality that makes it into the news media, where underneath is something much bigger and uglier and even more terrible than anything that we've ever, you know, experienced, anything that we've ever looked at.
It's quite, you know, telling and perhaps premonition. I mean, we talked about how this kid, I forget his name,
Abu Sin.
Yeah, he's not exactly the son of a prince. He's, you know, his name's Toothless. He's kind of a slum kid, and that's why he, to some degree, can't be expected to understand certain things. But he has the internet. He has a band broad enough to be able to chat with someone. So evidently, you know, I'm not saying he's not poor, but this is, you know, the floor of Saudi's economy slowly rising. And just like over here, even the poor kids are slowly, you know, getting hold of communication technology in which they can accidentally break their own laws just by using the technology. And, you know, we're seeing the first wave of what happens when poor kids get hold of rich technology, and they're going to face this kind of punishment. And, you know, like we said, this is the tip of the iceberg. They either have to start hiding absolutely everything, or being a bit more lenient. You know, after sort of postcards of what you think they're going to do.
Somebody said we're going to have like a world war with Islam. No, we're not. Because we are so much more technologically advanced and militarily superior that it would be a war that would be over in a day.
Like a world war with Islam? Is that what they're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, so tell me how that's not what's happening now.
Yeah, well, I mean, but I think what they mean is like a real war, not what's going on right now. I mean,
yeah, are they talking about a like bombings and all that stuff?
Yes.
Yeah. See, that's
not what's going to happen. The way Islam is going to take over the West, is by seducing the women, or and it may not even be Islam. it may actually be some sort of amalgamation between sort of like a religious feminism.
And it's not going to be the men seducing the women. It's not going to be sexual seduction. It's going to be this like we were talking about. God, what was her name? The chick in Playboy.
Noor Taguri.
Yeah, Taguri. It's a completely different type of seduction. It's a high pressure sales thing, and that's where it's going to happen. You know, like I said, that's the wedge.
Barry M. Deep replied, "You screamed at me. That was all you had. What you that was screaming. That wasn't screaming." I asked you what you're referring to as nuanced, and you never gave me an answer, so I can't go any further with what you have to say.
But I would say, as far as war, we're already in a world war. We've been in a world war for half my life, if not more. And, you know, make no mistake, this is how world war is fought now. We aren't probably going to see nukes unless somebody that has been third world until this century goes off without thinking. You won't see the U.S. shoot out nukes. You're not going to see any big country bomb somebody like that, because now they're all into this surgical strike thing. Now it's all ground wars. Now it's all psyops, you know, and drones. That's what World War is now.
Okay, well, it's... If you don't understand the nature of the beast, you will be ruled by it. And what my worry is that Islam will weld itself into our political structure via the avenues that I've outlined. And we'll probably be some amalgamation of Islamic in 100 years. So, yeah. Let's do that.
It's piggybacking onto feminism, and which feminism has already got us in a semi-religious state. We do not need a religious state. And this is an avenue for authoritarian social micromanagement. That is, throughout history, if you look at every single time there has been authoritarian social micromanagement, there has been genocide. There has been mass murder. There has been... And it doesn't necessarily have to be religion. But religion is a great avenue for it. Religion is great individually. Religion is great as in your church, in your neighborhood. It's a good way for you to have fellowship with people. It's not a good way to run your country.
All right.
Yeah, so, I think we're done.
I think we're done. We got nothing else to talk about in terms of
our
stories.
We got another incoming witch hunt about being Islam apologists, because we want to introduce nuance by recognizing that men are also victims of Islam.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll probably be accused of Islam apologists for saying that Islam is doubly bad, and that it's a dangerous thing to let it use feminism as an inroad into the government. That's definitely apology. That's of course it's apology.
It just strikes me that we're all becoming Islamocentric, because we are all revolving our opinions of each other around our opinions of Islam.
Mm-hmm. And it's funny that feminists keep saying patriarchy hurts men too, and no one calls them patriarchy apologists.
That is funny. All right, so I guess we're going to end the stream there. I'm going to leave it on. I'm going to leave the image on Mia Khalifa, who I think is someone who actually represents a Middle Eastern woman that's taking her life into her own hands and doing whatever the fuck she wants, and is really being a badass because she knows the risks that she's taking by doing so. And if you don't know who she is, I won't tell you. Just look it up yourself. Just make sure you're not at work when you do. And thanks, everybody, for coming on the stream. Thanks, Computing Forever, for joining us. Thanks, Allison, for popping in to give your 2 cents on the various stories that you spoke to. If you guys have any comments about our stories, just put them in the low bar chat area. Not the low bar. We have stuff in the low bar. You guys can't drive the low bar. We drive the low bar. I control the low bar. Yeah, just leave us a comment there, and we'll see you on the next Polecat Cast. Have a good night.